In December 1901, I was able for the first time, by means of stations specially constructed for that purpose, to transmit and receive telegraphic signals right across the Atlantic Ocean, from Paljou in Cornwall to St. John's, Newfoundland, a distance of about 1,800 miles. Early in 1902, during a voyage on the American line of Philadelphia to New York, I was able to receive signals from Paljou in Cornwall for the whole distance at night time, although during the day the transmission range fell to 700 miles. I was thus able to discover the now well-known fact that wireless signals transmitted by wavelengths of a few hundred meters can be received over much greater distances by night than during the hours of daylight. It was in June 1913 that Dr. Meissner employed the oscillating valve for the first time as carrier wave generator for transmitting speech between Berlin and Neuen, a distance of 23 miles. My first tests with a valve generator were made in the following year. In March 1914, I had the apparatus installed on an Italian warship at Augusta in Sicily, and the speech was received on a second vessel. The two ships steamed out to the high seas and for further tests off the Sicilian coast, and consistently, perfect reception was registered over a distance of 35 kilometers, a distance subsequently increased to 70 kilometers with very limited power. Communication was constantly maintained throughout a period of 12 hours, and experiments including periods when signals were transmitted entirely overseas and also when land intervened. One complete wireless installation was also sent to New York, and communication was established between New York and Philadelphia by telephone working both ways. On the outbreak of war, experiments in wireless telephony were discontinued commercially and were carried out only in connection with the military services as far as this country was concerned. But in America, commercial research continued. At the end of 1915, the American Telephone and Telegraph Company, working in conjunction with the Western Electric Company, succeeded, when conditions were favorable, in transmitting speech from the United States Naval Station at Arlington to the Eiffel Tower Station in Paris, a distance of 3,800 miles. On this occasion, over 300 valves or tubes were used in the oscillator and modulator circuits. On the conclusion of the war, it became possible for European countries to resume their tests, and in March 1919, with the object of demonstrating that transatlantic telephony could be achieved using comparatively small power, one-way communication was established and satisfactorily maintained for 10 days with Louisburg in Canada by transmission from my station at Ballybunion, Ireland, using a valve transmitter with only 2.5 kilowatt output from the generator, a wavelength of 3,800 meters, and an aerial 500 feet in height. In the same year, my assistant, Mr. Sears Franklin, carried out a shortwave telephony beam test on a very short wavelength, a wavelength of 15 meters, across the English Sea, a distance of 80 miles. And work on this wavelength was continued in 1921 when two-way telephone communication was established between Hendon and Birmingham, a distance of 97 miles, which case, however, reflectors or projectors were used. Then in 1921, following a successful test of duplex telephony on 100 meter wave between Chelmsford and Southend, experimental stations were erected by my engineers at Southwold and Zandvoort, Holland, which worked duplex across the North Sea using only 1 kilowatt of energy in the area. At Kristiansund, Norway, good quality telephony was received from these stations both at night and during the day. Whilst at Oslo, a distance of 700 miles, very loud and constant signals were received during the night, but the day reception was variable and uncertain. The year 1920 is memorable for a number of important wireless telephone transmissions which had both news and entertainment value and thus had the same character that broadcasting has today. To encourage public interest, demonstrations were given to show that no special skill was required to talk into the telephone and that musical items could be transmitted and satisfactorily received with ease. In February 1920, a program of vocal and instrumental music for 2 half-hourly periods each day for a fortnight was broadcast from the Chelmsford station using about 5 kilowatts in the area and the same wavelength of 2,800 meters which was being employed by Paul Jew for the news broadcast to ships. This was in order to test the range of the transmitter. Amateurs and shipping companies were advised and asked to send in reports. Dame Nellie Melbourne gave her first broadcast in June 1920 from this station and Laura Melchior in July. Worldwide interest was aroused by these broadcast concerts, and good reception was reported from distances as far away as Persia and Canada.